What's up, everybody? I'm super excited to announce a brand new series on my channel called Virtual Bike Shopping with Hardtail Party, where you get to tag along and be a fly on the wall as you watch me compare bikes online with the information provided by the manufacturers. In this series, we take fictional characters and we go look for the perfect bike for them and compare information online. This is a little behind the scenes sneak peek as to what I do for a lot of my patrons. I want to give a huge shout out to my patrons who make this channel possible. Let's get started. If you want me to do this for you, become a patron and we can work together and help you find the perfect bike. So today we're going to help Anthony find a new bike. Now, Anthony's a fictional character I made up. He's age 40. He lives in Sacramento, where there's some fantastic single track up there. Nothing too steep, nothing too chunky. He's getting back into mountain biking after 20 years off. He's athletic, but he wants to feel like a kid again and explore the mountains on his bike. His local dealer carries Marin, so today we're going to be looking at Marin bikes. And he's more interested in having fun on his bike than racing or setting Strava KOMs. He wants to get a little bit of air, and his budget is under $2,000. Let's go to Marin's website and see what we can find to help Anthony find the perfect bike. Here we are on Marin's website. I like that they've separated mountain from pavement and e-bikes, and it's really cool that we can jump straight to hardtails. Obviously, this is Hardtail Party. We're looking at hardtails. Here we've got mountain hardtail. Cool. Trail 27.5, so that means 27.5 wheels. Trail 27.5 plus. Yet right here it says it has 29x26 wheels. So that's super confusing. I would fix that if I were Marin. Besides, the San Quentin's more 27.5 plus than the Pine Mountain is. I don't know, that's confusing. Trail/sport. Now for a new person getting into this, or Anthony trying to get back into this, if he comes to Marin's website and he looks at this, he's gonna be confused. He's gonna say trail/sport. I'm athletic, I want a sport bike. I want something sporty. Maybe I'll start here, this is the sport bike. But I'm gonna take it on the trail. Do I want a trail or a sport? This is where marketing cliches and terms confuse the shopper and it actually hurts them. So the way Marin's using this is sport is entry level. It's like you don't have the budget for a true mountain bike, so we're gonna have a bicycle shaped object that has some mountain biking capabilities to it, but what Anthony's really looking for is a trail bike, but this trail/sport trail and sport is just confusing people. And then XC Race, I'm so glad they call this out, that these are race bikes for cross-country riding. That's not what he's looking for. Dirt jump, awesome. We got a dirt jump bike here. He wants to get a little air, but he's not primarily focusing on dirt jump. So let's take a look at some of the bikes in here. So over here, we've got a little blurb on the right, and these are sometimes helpful on websites, but usually it's just a whole bunch of marketing jargon to make you want to buy the bike, not to actually help you decide if this is the right one for you or not. Developed in conjunction with Matt Jones. So Anthony may or may not know who Matt Jones is. The San Quentin collection lives up to the notoriety of the namesake maximum security California State Prison. That doesn't help me. Blending the strength and style of our Alcatraz dirt jump frame with the natural trail savvy of the nail trail hardtail. So I'm going to scroll down the trail savvy of the nail hardtail, which I know nothing about if I'm Anthony. Alcatraz is dirt jump, so I'm going to assume this can dirt jump and trail. The San Quentin family of aggressive trail hardtails is the perfect mashup for the modern trail rider. Well, cool, I'm a modern trail rider. I want that. So here we can see where marketing mumbo jumbo, I'm gonna call it. These guys have to sell bikes. So of course there's gonna be copy that entices you to buy the bike. That is not helpful for a new rider. Here we go. If you follow Matt Jones on YouTube, you're probably gonna just see Matt Jones say, hey, that's awesome, I want it, because Matt Jones rides it. All right, so we got the same blurb here, and we've got the three and the two, and the one, and the frame kit. Now, some companies, the one is the premier bike, and the three is the entry-level bike. So I'm a little bit confused. I obviously know the difference because I'm familiar with Marin, but someone new to this wouldn't be. So the first thing I can do is click on it. I've got to edit up there some marketing stuff. Look at the MSRP, $900 for the one. And then I'll come up here to the three and see it's $2,000. So the three must be the better one. So we've kind of got these options here, and I'm going to assume they're all the same thing because they're all San Quentins. However, we have to be super careful with that. Let me show you why. San Quentin one. You're not going to see this. This has the same exact blurb from all the rest. It's for downhill trails, light dirt jump, and enduro. So let's take a look at the spec. This is where you're going to get bit. Frame, series 2 6061 aluminum, double butted frame, 141 millimeter open dropout. Anthony's not going to know what that means, but I know what that means, and let me explain. An open dropout has a quick release and the wheel slides out instead of a hole that the bolt goes through. So on the San Quentin 1, we have 141 mil open dropouts, but on the San Quentin 3, we've even got a picture of it here, on the frame, right in here, you can see this bolt goes through. They're not open dropouts. So when I look at the spec, it's a series 3 frame. It's still 6061 aluminum, double butted frame, internal routing, external brake, but it has a 121 by 148 through axle. So if you don't know your stuff and you think, oh good, I can buy a San Quentin 1 for $900 and then just upgrade the fork as stuff breaks, the San Quentin 1 is not the same as the 2 and the 3. In fact, the wheels from the San Quentin 1 won't fit on a 2 or a 3. That is a big bummer. And if you don't know your stuff, you could get stuck with the San Quentin 1. And there's a big difference between these frames. That through axle makes an enormous difference. And this is one of my pet peeves when frame manufacturers make a different version between the same. If they just put all the same frame on all these and put really cheap components on here, at least you're getting the same frame and it's worth upgrading. So I really dislike that. All right, let's take a look at the difference between the San Quentin 2 and the 3. So here on the San Quentin 2, we've got an MSRP of $1,350. Let's take a look at some of the specs. Frame is a Series 3 6061 frame. It's got internal shifter and dropper routing. I like that it has external brake. I'm a huge fan of that. 12 by 148 boost through axle. I like that. Threaded bottom bracket. We got a RockShox Recon RL, 110 by 15 millimeter boost spacing, 130 mil travel. Let's see what else we got. 27.5 by 2.3 tires, SRAM NX 11 speed. Okay, Tektro hydraulic disc. We've got a Marin mini riser, 28 mil rise bars. And we've got a regular seat post, not a dropper. Hubs are generic hubs. They're not name brand. Okay, so for, what was this, $1,400? $1,350, we get a rigid post, no dropper, and a middle-of-the-line fork. Okay, not bad. NX11 speed. Let's go take a look at the San Quentin 3. San Quentin 3, this is still in our budget of $2,000. This comes with a Revelation. I like that a lot more. It's got 35 mil stanchions, still a 130 mil travel bike, same frame, still boost with the through axle. Let's see, hubs. We still have generic hubs. This is interesting. This has center lock, whereas the other ones had six bolt. We've got Shimano MT400 hydraulics on here. Here we've got 27.5 by 2.6 tires. Okay. And then we've got an SLX 11 speed rear. And I'm gonna think that's a little bit dated with 12 speed out, but that's okay. It's $2,000 for a hardtail. And we do have an X Fusion dropper. Budget dropper, pretty budget parts on everything. I like the Revelation. I don't feel like that needs to be upgraded. SLX 11 speed is just fine. I like that it's got a little bit bigger tires. Let's see, it's still on 29 inner rims though. That's a bummer with the 2.6. That's a pretty narrow rim for such a wide tire. Let's look at the geometry. Stack is super low. If you've asked me about a San Quentin, you know that this is my biggest complaint about this bike. The stack is super low, and even with the 25 mil riser bar, it's not enough. You need a bigger bar. Reach is modern. I'm usually around a medium, and I like 440 to 450 in my mediums. That's a pretty modern reach. 65-degree head angle. Love that, especially with the 130 fork. Let's see, effective seat tube, 75. Not too bad. We're going to look at chainstay, 425. That should be playful. It's pretty short. Great, 175 mil cranks. Not a huge fan of that, but I haven't ridden it. But usually I like 170 mil cranks with the rocky terrain I live in. But Anthony's in Sacramento and there's not a ton of rocks. There's some, but not a ton. So this could be a good option for him. Let's go look at the other hardtails and see what's available. All right, so now we're on the trail 27.5 plus. And I notice all these bolts on here and the cool tan walls. This bike looks awesome. Let's see what the copy says. The new Marin Pine Mountain. Okay, I feel good because it's new. And that tells me it's not going to be replaced next year. This is kind of a new model. It's a fresh take on what an adventure trail bike should be capable of. Okay, I like to have adventures. All new Series 1 and 2 chromoly frames. I don't know what that means. It's been constructed around 29x26. I do know what that means, but if I'm Anthony, I don't. With geometry blending the stability and ruckus fun of aggressive trail geometry with all-day comfort and pedalability for a wide variety of trail. If I'm Anthony, I'm thinking, hey, cool, that sounds fun. Ruckus fun, aggressive geo, all-day comfort, and it's great for a wide variety of trails. But then I say, hey, isn't that kind of what this was too, or this is... You know, it blends the strength and style of the dirt jumper with the natural trail savvy of the... Anyway, this marketing copy doesn't really help you. It's just kind of wordy stuff to get you hooked on the bike. A plethora of eyelets on the frame and the bedroll bar let you customize your bike and gear to each and every adventure. Wide range drivetrains and sturdy trail construction. Suspension forks make sure you can get out and back with a smile and a story worth telling. Obviously, they're marketing this for adventure, bike packing, that sort of thing, hauling stuff on your bike. Anthony may or may not know that. Let's go take a look at it. If you haven't already seen my review on this bike, go check it out. All right, so this is the Pine Mountain 1 and 2. Let's see if there's a difference between the frame. They mentioned Series 1 and Series 2, which is confusing because in the other Marin, it was Series 2 and Series 3. So I could watch a little video here and maybe see how people, how it's intended to be used. If I see guys with a whole bunch of bags on it, which I'm seeing in the pictures, okay, maybe this is more about adventure and carrying a lot of gear, maybe having a picnic on the trail, maybe spending the night, and less about jumping. Sometimes that's safe to assume with these videos, sometimes it's really not. MSRP is $1,400. Adventure, bike packing, all day epics, trail riding. Now every bike they have in their lineup says trail riding, which makes sense because we all want to ride on the trails, but it's not super helpful to know that. Okay, so let's look at the spec. Series 2, okay, this is super confusing. The Pine Mountain 1 has a Series 2 frame with 141x9mm open dropout. Once again, quick release dropouts, not boost. So if you want to buy a new wheel set for this, you can't buy a boost wheel set with an asterisk on it. Some boost wheel sets can be converted down to 141x9 quick release, but people like Anthony aren't going to know that, and they're not going to want to go through all that research to find which hubs can and which hubs can't. They want a bike that they can buy, and in 2 years when they're ready for a nice wheel set, they can buy what's common, which is boost, and put it on their bike. He's going to be disappointed if he buys a wheel set to fit on this that doesn't fit. So the Pine Mountain 1 has a Series 2 frame. Let's go see what the Pine Mountain 2 has. Pine Mountain 2 has a Series 3 frame. Okay, now I'm really confused because when I come in here, it says the all-new Series 1 and Series 2 chromoly frames. So I get it that someone runs this website and people make mistakes. When you're a shopper and you see this, you are extremely confused. You're thinking, where's the Series 1 frame and where's the Series 2? So the Pine Mountain 1 has the Series 2 frame and the Pine Mountain 2 has the Series 3 frame. Super confusing. This is why people pay me to help them find bikes, because it's really easy to get turned around. All right, spec, Series 3 frame has 148x12 boost through axle. So there's a big difference there, and that's also frustrating that the Pine Mountain 1 and the Pine Mountain 2 look identical, but they do not share the same frame. You can't put the wheels from this one on the other one, and vice versa. That's a bummer. So we can look at some of this stuff. It's got a Trans X dropper. That's great. Price was a little over budget. So even though the MSRP is $2,099, usually shops sell them for less than MSRP. So we gotta be real careful when we're comparing this to other bikes that aren't sold in shops that are direct to consumer, like Commensal. Commensal, the price is what it is. This MSRP of $2,099 is what your shop is recommended to sell it for, but they almost always sell it for less. So I should be comparing this closer to $1,700 or $1,800 bikes that are direct. Geometry, head angle, we've got a 66.5, okay. Stack, oh, this is a way higher stack than the San Quentin, and it has a taller bar, so this should feel more upright, more comfortable. Reach is shorter than the San Quentin. Remember, the San Quentin was 444 on the medium, so the bars are going to be a little bit closer when we're standing up on the pedals. That'll make for a more comfortable day in the saddle, but it'll feel less aggressive on steep, aggressive terrain. So let's see, chain stays 430. That's nice. That's a good all-around number. Crank length 175. Once again, I wish this came with 170s. Hey, this is pretty cool. We've got these frame measurements that I could send to a frame bag company and they can make me a custom frame. Okay, so that's an option. I am not gonna recommend the Pine Mountain 1 to Anthony, because the reason you buy a hardtail over $1,000 is to get a good frame that you can upgrade over time that will still be great. So I'm gonna recommend the Pine Mountain 2 if he wants more adventure stuff. All right, let's go back to the other hardtails. So now we're in the trail slash sport category. The Nail Trail represents everything a trail hardtail should be. Durable and lightweight, Series 3 aluminum alloy frames feature compliance-enhancing fastback stays. Hey, I've heard Hardtail Party talk about compliance before. That's a good thing. Maybe this frame will be compliant. Marketing wants you to think it is, but is it actually? We'll have to see. I would look for a review from me or other people to see if it's compliant or not. I'm at least glad that they're thinking about compliance there, especially on an aluminum frame. Internal dropper routing, 148 by 12 boost spacing, good. I don't have to worry about having quick release axles. It's through axles. And long and low trail geometry for single tracks, and long and low trail geometry for single track speed and a trail playfulness not usually seen in hardtails. Who wouldn't want that? I want a trail that's playful, way more playful than you normally see in hardtails. 120 mil suspension forks. Hey, we got a 12 speed drivetrain. Great, this sounds awesome. It's long and low. They didn't mention slack. Let's go take a look. So this could be the perfect bike. And hey, it's only $1,350. Pretty good looking bike. Not bad. It looks like all round trail. I'll watch the video and see a couple people jumping around on it and say, hey, that's about what I want for if I'm Anthony. All right, let's take a look, see what we got. Series 3 frame. I'm starting to see a pattern. I think all Series 3 frames are boost through axle. I could be wrong, but I'm starting to come to that conclusion. 27.5 inch wheels, except I'm kind of confused that it says that there, and then over here on tires it says 29 by 2.3 slash 27.5 by 2.3. Makes you wonder if it's a mullet. Super confusing. RockShox Recon RL, not a bad fork. All right. Hubs, hey, at least we have a name brand hub here. That's good. We've got Shimano hydraulic brakes with a center lock rotor, SRAM SX 12 speed, seat post, no dropper, bummer. But that's okay, it's pretty cheap. Okay, there we can see it's a tapered headset. All right, not bad, let's take a look at the geometry. This could be a great, great trail bike, especially for the price if the geo's right. We could add a dropper for a couple hundred bucks and have a great little ripper. Geometry. Stack is kind of in between the San Quentin and the Pine Mountain. Reach, oh, here we go, M27.5 and a medium 29. So the small is 27.5, the large and XL is 29, and the medium, they have a medium 27.5 and a medium 29. So let's take a look. Head tube angle, 68 degrees. That's not going to be playful. Even in Sacramento, that's more XC than I want to see. And it's ironic that the Pine Mountain, which is the like adventure bike, is a degree and a half slacker than this. And a degree and a half doesn't sound like a lot. It makes a huge difference. So this is going to ride twitchier than the Pine Mountain. Let's look at the chainstay. On the medium 27.5, it's 425, which is nice. And on the medium 29, it's a centimeter longer at 435. Not bad. A little bit longer, a little more stable on that 29er wheel. And that makes sense for the bigger bikes. I think that's cool that Marin is having a bigger rear end on the bigger sizes and a shorter rear end on the smaller sizes. Built around a modern, oh, interesting, a 44 mil offset on 27.5, but a 51 mil offset on the 29s. Okay, I've never seen that before. And once again, we have 175 mil cranks on the medium. Let's take a look at reach. This is interesting. The 27.5 model has a longer reach than the 29er model. Let me look at the wheelbase. I'm kind of curious about that. So at least the wheelbase is a little longer on the 29. But I'd want a little more reach on the 29er, personally. Kind of weird. So, yeah, this could be a great bike. If this had a 66-degree head angle, I think this would be at the top of my recommendation. But with the 68, it'll be okay for Sacramento. But he wants to feel like a kid again and have fun. I don't know if this is the right one. Let's go look at some other models. All right, here we go. Next up, the Bobcat Trail, Trail/Sport. The Bobcat Trail family of mountain bike hardtails are designed for the riding, looking for a capable single track machine. Hey, what do you know? That's Anthony. Featuring everything you need to have a great ride. That's Anthony. The heart and soul of the great ride stems from the lightweight Series 2 aluminum frame with long and low trail geometry and 27.5 or 29 wheels. Interesting, I wonder why they didn't mention 27.5 or 29 wheels on the nail trail, but they did here. 120 mil of rock garden ready travel and internal housing routing. All Bobcat Trail models feature hydraulic disc brakes and are available with a wide range off-road specific drivetrains. Great, that sounds really neat and it looks cool. I like the tan walls. Let's check it out. Whoa, okay, so we got a 5, 4, and a 3. I wonder why we don't have a 2 and a 1. I'm a little confused about that. Okay, the 5 looks like the best one. Ooh, but this one's the coolest color, so I'm going to pick this one. Oh, wait, I can see it's got multiple. It's got a front derailleur. I want the 1 by. Let's look at the 5. So, here we go. Hey, this is right in the budget, $949. Fantastic. Series 2 frame. 27.5 or 29 wheels. Now, someone might be confused and think, hey, it fits both. 68 mil BB shell. This bike's starting to feel like a bike from the 90s. Yes, it has a threaded bottom bracket, but the shell's narrower. And check it out, 135 mil forged dropouts. So 135 is pre-boost. It's pre-boost. This is the old school. So if you have old school parts and you want to revive them and put them on here, they're going to be 26 inch and it may not be a great idea anyway, but this is so old school it's going to be hard to find parts for. Internal housing and dropper post routing. Bummer, I'd rather this doesn't have internal brake routing, but whatever, he's going to buy it complete. Rims 29 mil inner like everything else. A 100 by 15 front hub, so non-boost. So yeah, this is really going to be hard to upgrade. If I want a wheel set, I'm going to have to buy a 135 mil old school hub, which I doubt I could get in like an i9 or an Onyx, maybe, but not likely. It's got good tires, WTB Trail Boss tires, 27.5 or 29 by 2.5 wire bead. Not a fan of that. Not a folding tire. These may not set up tubeless. Okay, the rims are at least tubeless compatible. I'm not sure if the tires are going to be. Shimano Dior rear, it's 1x11. Okay, that's fine. Cassette, hey, I like this. It's a Sunrace 11-46 tooth. I actually think this is a fantastic drivetrain and a fantastic budget bike, except for those things like the narrow hub on the back that doesn't fit many modern wheels. Let's take a look. We've got Seat post 30.9, so at least that'll fit a dropper. It doesn't come with a dropper, but it'll fit. And this is the high-end Bobcat Trail. Let's look at the geometry. Head angle 67.5. Hey, this is even more modern than that Nail Trail. Kind of funny. And then when you go to the 29er, it's even slacker. That's interesting. You usually see it the other way around. So even though this is a budget bike in the trail slash sport category, it's got some of the more modern geometry. The reach is far more modern than a Nail Trail. The head angle is a degree slacker. I like that, which is weird. You'd think the better one would have a little bit more modern trail geo. The stack is really nice and modern. Interesting that the 29er has a slacker head angle than the 27.5. What else we got? Chainstay 425, that's fun on a 27.5. 440, that's a little long for 29. It'll be great for large and XL, but medium, I wish it was a little shorter, but still not a deal breaker. You can still see the reach is longer than the chainstay, which is great. Once again, Marin's going 175 cranks on medium, large, and XL. But still, I think this bike is more modern and it's gonna be more fun to ride than the Nail Trail, which is priced a tier above it. So unfortunately, this does not have a tapered head tube, I believe. I could be wrong. It doesn't tell me on the fork here. Let me look this up. SR Sun Tour XCX. At least it's a through axle front, that's good. So here's Sun Tours. This looks tapered though. Okay, so I will have to call my Marin dealer and find out if this is tapered. If it is, good for Marin. That would be really dumb not to do tapered in this day and age, so maybe I can upgrade the fork. That's gonna be good if so. But the one thing that's steering me away from this is that 135 mil rear axle. It's just, can it be worked around? Sure. You could buy this for $1,000, you could throw a dropper on it and a nice fork and actually have a pretty nice bike. It looks like it's gonna be compliant with these thin stays. Could be really fun. The Geo's pretty modern. That one glaring thing is that 135 mil rear axle though, and most people are not gonna catch that. You're not gonna know that. You're gonna buy it based on looks, based on the marketing jargon with it, and then you're gonna find out a year later when you try to upgrade the wheel set, there's really not a lot of great options in the 135 mil. If this was 148 boost in the rear, that'd be the no-brainer. This would be the bike to get because it's got the better geometry, more modern geometry, more playful, better on the trail. It can handle more all-rounder. And even though it's got a cheap fork that doesn't have air and tokens and stuff you can adjust, it'll get you started and get you back hooked on riding, and then you can upgrade it soon. So this is what I'd recommend for Anthony. Throw a dropper on there and have a blast on this thing with the caveat that it's got that quick release 135 rear axle, which is a major bummer. That's probably enough of a bummer that I won't recommend it. And those wire bead tires, if they had folding bead and they were tubeless ready, that'd be great. But having to replace tires, that's gonna cost you $120 minimum. So this looks like it's aimed a little more for a kid. I wish it was $1,100 with better tires and a through axle 148 mil rear. Then this would be the bike to get. All right, let's go back, see if there's anything else we missed on the hardtails, because that was a nice, pleasant surprise, even though it was the lower end one. It had more exciting geometry than the Nail Trail here. Sport, I don't think this is going to be for him. It looks heavy and clunky and cheap. The Wildcat, but when I look at this, it's for women's riders. So I think the Wildcat is really just a Bobcat Trail for women. The XC race bike, it would work in Sacramento, but like he said, he's wanting to get a little bit of air, feel like a kid again, not be XC. Let's take a look at it anyway while we're here looking at Marin stuff. Look at the spec. So this has a 148 mil boost through axle. Love seeing that. It's got a tapered headset. Love seeing that. RockShox Judy. It's okay, not too bad, but at least it's boost. Now some bikes are boost in the rear and not in the front. We hardly ever see that, but Santa Cruz was doing that for a while. They had all these non-boost forks they bought and they were pushing them out the door, and the fork was 100 mil and the rear was 148. And that means when you bought a wheel set, your boost front wheel wouldn't fit in it. So always check these things. Let's see. Dang it, these have a wire bead as well. That is a bummer. Especially on, oh, it's only $13.50. This would be a great little bike for a Nika racer who wants to do well this season. Maybe it's their second mountain bike and they're going to do a lot of racing. Great price point for that. Geometry, head tube angle 69 degrees. That's great for an XC bike. Chainstay 435. Stack is nice and tall. Reach, yeah, that looks right on par where it should be for an XC bike. So if Anthony's daughter is going to start Nika this year, this is the bike I'm going to recommend for her from Marin. So let's go back and look at our overviews again. This San Quentin, if we do it, it's going to be a 2 or a 3. We are not going to recommend the 1 because it's got that axle that's not even boost. If we go to the Pine Mountain, I don't think that's quite for him. He's not doing a lot of adventure stuff. He wants to get air. He wants to have a little bit more fun trail experience. But what's crazy is this bike is slacker and more aggressive than both of these, and it's the adventure one. I think if the Nail Trail had a 66-degree head angle, this would be the choice. And I think if the Bobcat Trail had a 148mm boost rear axle, that would be the choice. And that's out of the question, and the XC race bike. So man, if he had to buy, I would recommend the Pine Mountain or the San Quentin. Probably the San Quentin, but I'd recommend he save up and get a bar with like a 50mm rise because that stack is super low. I still don't know that he needs something quite as aggressive as this, especially in Sacramento, though. I really wish this had a 148 rear. I think that would be the bike to beat. Or if these had the Geo of the Pine Mountain. So this is the process I go through when I help consult people on bikes. I don't tell them all this stuff. I do it in my head. And when they say, hey, I'm about to buy the San Quentin 1 because it's cheaper, I can stop them and say, don't buy it. It has the outdated non-boost quick-release wheels. That frame is not the same as the 2, and I'm able to save them a lot of money. That's why I offer the service, and I actually know most of this stuff already because I don't need to go to the website because I've been here 10 times, and so I know most common bikes and what the pitfalls are and where the holes are and where the gaps are, and I'm able to save people time and money and heartache buying the wrong frame that isn't compatible with modern stuff. So if you want to learn to do it yourself, I'm all for that. Don't use me. Learn how to do it yourself. That's great. That's why I'm building a course on geometry and what it means and on how to shop online and stuff like that. In the meantime, make sure you're subscribed so you can catch my next video I do of this. I'm going to have another customer. I'm going to have another brand that I go through, and I will walk you through the comparison of all the models so that you can see my process. This has been super fun. I know it's been long, but thanks for watching. I hope you learned something. Post up in the comments below what you learned and what bike company you want me to see next and what my next fake customer should be like. I hope you learned something. If you did learn something and it's valuable, consider supporting this channel. For as little as $5 a month, you can make a big difference and help me make more of these videos more often. There's a party in the mountains and you're invited.